Okay, our next speaker is Deb Campbell. No vote. So she's going to talk on the indigo. Indigo is a very important part of the French bowling. They spoke about one of the gentlemen who traveled through this area in his writings talked about how the people were all dressed in blue. So it's very important. They use a lot of indigo back then. So here's Deb Campbell. I should mention one thing that in dealing with local talent like we are with the people that we know that are doing the reenacting and not going overseas or out of the country to find somebody to speak. Deb is one of our members and very knowledgeable in the what she's going to be talking about. So I'd like to give you Deb the floor.
Thank you. I will, my esteemed colleague, will be handing out these handouts there. What is on there is a timeline of dying history. This is one of those topics, it really is too much information. I tried to pull out the information that I thought would be really helpful. My presentation sort of mirrors Becky's and Ted's to some extent regarding the trade and some of the other things that happened. Maybe not so much on the French end of things. Okay, a little bit about me. I've been doing living history for 40 years now. And I, unlike a lot of the folks in the Malise, I travel through time, so I can do 1750 through 1860. In a couple weeks, I'll be doing a Civil War event here in St. Genevieve for the high school. I'm also the historian for the Scottish Games in St. Louis. And I don't have any French blood, I'll tell you right now. I am a Scot. But I can do it, okay? It's all right. It's all right. So this is a very wide, broad subject. Sandra is going to advance the slides for me. She's also my esteemed colleague. And we're going to get into this. As you can see, I'm a master gardener, too. And I have been a master gardener since 2000. And I do a lot of speaking here in St. Genevieve. And I will be speaking at the Garden Walk on May 13th at Felix Valley. And I'll be talking about lavender. So if anybody's interested, contact Felix Valley. So, indigo. And the first slide is a brick of indigo. Now, something a lot of folks don't realize is the value. A brick this size, and you see it's 2.5 inches square, at the time would have been about $3,000. But we're going to talk about the production and what it takes to get from the plant to this. Also, something that I didn't mention is we have the actual science experiment going on in the back parking lot. I have an indigo dye vat that's cooking right now. And some of my fellow reenactors have ponied up with some good items that we're going to use to dye. Ray has provided some shirts, and these are wet, and we're going to enter them into the dye vat, and you're going to see the process. It truly is a chemical experiment, okay? So getting into the presentation, blue is one of nature's rarest colors. It is so brilliant that visible indigo light has a wavelength of about 445 nanometers. It's only outdone by violet. So what that means is, the first color, if you could take all the colors away, the first color that I can see is violet, the next is blue, and then it carries on from there. Our eyes are actually more sensitive to blue light. Newton used indigo to describe one of the two new primary colors he added to the five he'd originally named in his revised account of the rainbow in Lectio's Optisae of 1675. So check out your timeline. We're going to talk about that too. There's a tremendous amount of information on there. Indigo is one of the oldest dyes, and in Becky's presentation and also in Ted, you saw blue, and that's where that blue came from. It did have some competitors. We'll get into that later, but if you see blue typically throughout history, it was from indigo. Okay, so indigo is a dye, and it is obtained from the plant. from the tiny leaves of small shrubs that are part of the Indigofera tribe, and it creates the bluest of the blues. So these are unassuming little plants, but they provide a tremendous amount of color. For almost five millennia, in every culture and in every religion, indigo has been one of the world's most valued pigments. No color has been prized so high or for so long or been at the center of such turbulent human encounters. Next slide. So it was part of the Trans-Saharan trade. The peak was from the 8th until the late 16th century. And some of the dates that I have here are mirrored in your handout, but these are the ones that really stood out regarding indigo in blue. It was carried by camel. Next slide, please. And something that I did not realize, they didn't overload their camels. They carried about 30 pounds each. The reason for that was these were prized animals and they provided everything to these people. So they took very, very good care of them. The other reason that typically they only carried 30 pounds, especially of indigo, is it was so valuable. So if something happened to one camel or they got robbed, they would only lose one camel's worth of indigo. You can think about that. Okay, but you know, the camels were the power desert ships, and they carried indigo along with African captives, gold, salt, and other sumptuary items like ivory and ostrich feathers to Mediterranean hubs where there were African, Arab, Asian, and European markets. The average camel, of course, could carry about 30 pounds. So now we fast forward to the Middle Ages. And again, you know, this is a lot of information, so I tried to pick out the good stuff because I it's kind of like Ted, you know, can talk about powder horns for like a whole day, and I could talk about this for about a whole week, so I had to pick up the good stuff because, you know, I didn't want to bore you to tears. So in the Middle Ages, Italians expanded the commerce across Europe where indigo was in great demand for textile manufacturing because of its superiority to European woad in color, fastness, and fiber compatibility. Woad is one of the big competitors. We're going to talk about that. But it never really became all that popular because, like many of the plant dyes, and I realize indigo is a plant dye, they weren't light fast. And the number one question I get when I sell my yarns, which are dyed with Cushing dye, this is synthetic dye, is why don't you use plant dyes? And, you know, I've used, I think, all of them. But I don't use them for sale, yarn for sale, because the color fades away. And there's no way to prevent that from happening. When they come out of the dye pot, they're gorgeous, and they're vibrant, and they're just, you know, you wouldn't want anything any better. But put that color in bright light for a week, and it fades almost to nothing. And I don't want to sell a product that's going to has a color that's going to completely go away. So anyway, indigo was used for art and decorative architecture. Indigo was a rare, refulgent, and costly material. In Christian, Islamic, and Jewish cultures, indigo was used to symbolize the ancient caliphate, the royal court, the church and mosque, the canopy of heaven, and a royal person's holy robes. It was referred to as blue gold, and it had great value. And the market, because of the distance that had to be traveled to get the dye stuff, you know, think Europe, don't think here, we're not there yet. The strange and difficult alchemy necessary for production, its power to bewitch, and a lot of that had to do with the oxidation where it goes from green to blue, its translucent beauty, the value and demand for indigo became ungovernable. It threatened woad production and sparked bitter trade wars, touched off impassioned European and North American legislation, political debate, and it became known as the devil's blue dye. All right, next slide. So we're going to talk about the sea routes to India, and our prime player in that is Vasco da Gama. Next slide, please. In 1498, and he was Portuguese. He blazed the sea route to India, opened up the direct trade with the subcontinent, In doing so, he made indigo much more accessible to the average European. Prior to that time, Arab trades carried the dye and dyed fabrics along the caravan routes. The length and danger of the journey made indigo extremely expensive. Okay, now we advance to the slave trade. It started out transatlantic. So, you know, think prior to settlements here in the United States. Indigo was a cornerstone. It was one of the hidden commodities, like cotton, sugar, salt, and gold, that fueled the European colonial empires and compounded the extraordinary wealth and power of the African ones. The slave trade was part of that. And 100,000 slaves, black or mulatto, work in sugar mills and cocoa plantations, sacrificing their lives to gratify our newly acquired appetites for sugar, coffee, and tobacco, things unknown to our ancestors. And this is Voltaire. And, as Becky said, people got to have stuff. And this kind of mirrors that. So even though indigo isn't mentioned in this quote, it's important to note the number of people who were enslaved during this period of time, the number of people it took to produce the goods that were actually in demand. So, you know, that involved not only what Becky was talking about, what Ted was talking about, but everything that you can think of, it required the slave labor. Okay. So this is an amazing person. She was really the catalyst behind the indigo production that started in the United States. Believe it or not, indigo grew wild along the southern coast of the United States. The other thing that you would find if you were to walk some of the areas here, you would find that that very indigo that produces the dye actually grows wild here as well. The plants are very unassuming. You would not really notice them if you weren't looking for them. And most common, they grow along the Highway 21 corridor between Festus and all the way into Potosi. There are quite a few plants that grow in that area. So in the mid-1700s, Eliza, the 16-year-old daughter of a South Carolina plantation owner who was trained as a botanist, was given indigo seeds and soon discovered that her slaves had skill with indigo cultivation and indigo dye production. Frost killed her first crop, worms ate the second crop, and in the third year, 1742, the crop survived. Aware that indigo was in great demand in European textile industries, coveted by gentry, soldiers and workers alike, and that U.S. indigo would be cheaper than imports from Africa and Asia, she decided to convince other planters to actually cultivate the indigo. Now think about this, she's 16 years old. She's living at a time when women weren't supposed to do anything, and certainly weren't heard, and she convinces other planters to cultivate this crop. And unbeknownst to them at the time, they really didn't realize the value. So you can imagine what that must have been like. She used most of her crop of 1744 to make seed, which she shared with a great number of planters. In 1745-46, South Carolina exported 5,000 pounds of indigo dye. Now we're going to talk about the production here in a bit. By 1748, indigo had turned South Carolina into one of the wealthiest of the 13 colonies. That's a lot to think about. At the time, that much indigo would have been about 2.4 shillings per pound. And I don't know what that translates to our monies today, but I think it was substantial. Okay, next slide. So she managed three separate plantations, which I find amazing. Consider her age, consider the time period. She produced a crop more profitable than rice, and because it had properties to repel mosquitoes, it actually had even higher returns because there weren't so many slaves dying. Think about that. And it's because They were now raising indigo crops, and they were out of the rice fields where all the water was, so they weren't so exposed to the mosquitoes, and therefore malaria and yellow fever. It is documented that during the time, colonials rubbed indigo juice into horses' harnesses, and it was used as an excellent herbal repellent. So think in terms of the diversion of the slaves from the rice fields to the indigo fields, and there is documentation to show that 40 years of the indigo bonanza correspond to a 40-year decline in malaria deaths in the absence of yellow fever epidemics during that time period in the Carolinas. It's pretty profound. By the eve of the revolution, cubes of indigo replaced paper currency, and South Carolina planters were exporting 1.1 million pounds of indigo to Europe. That's nearly $30 million today. Think about that. For contributions to South Carolina's agriculture, Eliza Lucas Pinckney was the first woman to be inducted into the South Carolina Business Hall of Fame in 1753 at an audience with Augusta, the Dowager Princess of Wales, in London. Eliza presented the princess with a dress made of silk produced on the Pinckney plantation. So that tells us not only did they raise indigo, they raised silk. And that was another really big crop at the time. Not very well harvested. There were a lot of problems with it. Didn't last very long. In 1792, President George Washington served as pallbearer at her funeral at St. Peter's Church in Philly. She lived 71 years. So we need to give Eliza a big hand. You know, talk about what a gal. Yeah. Okay, so fast forward to the Revolutionary War. Look at the blue. Look at the blue. Where do you think the blue came from? Our friend indigo. So this actually marked the beginning of the weakening of American indigo profits. There was a collapse of indigo profits due to a lot of it, the India's production. India's production was so lucrative that villagers were forced to harvest plants by means of terror and torture. And it was said that no indigo box was dispatched to England without being smeared in human blood. Resistance to that tyranny sparked a two-year peasant revolt, the Indigo Revolt of 1859. Gandhi joined it as his first civil action. And the revolt brought a final end to the mass cultivation of indigo in the colonies. Pretty sad. Also, remember, you know, we're going to fast forward again to the Civil War, and thinking, you know, of the textile trade and all the other things that were going on. The Civil War hastened the invention of the cotton gin in 1874. It promoted the rapid industrialization of textile manufacturing, and that included the spinning jenny, the flying shuttle, water power and Watt steam engine, and the introduction of synthetic blue dyes. And remember, during that time, the dollar had no strength, and indigo cakes were still used as currency. So indigo had competitors. There were two. We talked about woad. Woad is Itaxis tentoria. It's a yellow-flowered European plant of the cabbage family. And it was popular early on, but it's a plant dye, and it didn't stick around. So you may have started out with a brilliant blue, and you wound up with some faded blue at some point. The other one was Dyer's knotweed. That was Pressicaria tentoria, and that is a species of the flowering plant in the buckwheat family. It's also called Chinese indigo, so if you ever hear that, that's one of the competitors. Okay, so now we're going to talk about production, and you'll have to forgive me, I'm one of those science number people. You know, I have a background in nuclear physics and all kinds of other things that I try not to tell people about because they look at me like, you're really weird. Can't help it. But I like to know why things happen the way they do. You know, I like to know the chemical process. But we're going to talk a little bit about the slaves again. Go ahead, Sandra. A single slave could plant and care for 2 acres of indigo. Each acre could yield 80 pounds. Okay, think acre, think 80 pounds. Prices in 1761 averaged 3.2 shillings per pound. Each indigo slave generated nearly 13 pounds annually, which is roughly equivalent to 2 grand today. Okay, so think in terms of acreage and think what it would take to maintain that acre. Once cut, the plant was stacked upright in formations resembling rice or wheat shocks, and it was loaded on wagons and carried to the closest set of processing vats. The process demands a high volume of fresh water to continually refill the vats during the processing seasons. That is one set of vats for every 7 acres of plant. So think how extensive this was. Think, you know, the one plantation was how big? How many acres that would be, and what kind of process this was. It was huge. So the first vat is, and this is a modern depiction. I couldn't find any really good pictures from the time period of the actual vats. This is a modern depiction. The first vat is called the steeper or the hot tub. It's approximately 18 feet square and 2 feet deep. So the fresh cut plants were covered with water and weighted down by strips of lumber or boards. And after they soaked for 12 to 18 hours, and temperature was a key. You know, think Carolinas, think really hot, humid conditions. Fermentation began, and there was a bubbling and boiling agitation that started with the plants. It culminated in a blue or purple froth rising to the top of the water. Now, it is common knowledge that rotting indigo vegetation smelled so hideous that even buzzards and livestock refused to frequent the area around the indigo dye vat. So you probably, if you were getting close to an indigo plantation, you smelled it long before you saw it. It was the task of the indigo maker to read signs correctly and to terminate the fermentation at the appropriate time. And that also included the obnoxious odors of putrefaction, okay? Note that the noxious odors continued for up to 6 months while all 3 cuttings of the plants were processed. So they had 3 crops per year. So it was El Stinko for a long time, long time. Okay, next slide. So this is a little bit better depiction of the time period, but it doesn't really give you a clear picture of the bat. It shows them carrying the plants. This is called the battery or beater bat. And it too was 15 feet square and 2 feet deep and slightly lower than the steeper vat. So workers agitated this liquid in the vat. They beat the water with paddles that helped to oxidize the solution and prompt the chemical reaction. So the beating lasted 25 to 35 minutes. And when the liquid would turn a deep green and appear to have a small muddy grain, then they knew it was red. That's when they added the lime water. Okay, what's lime? Base, acid? Okay, thank you. So it prompted the clear liquid to rise to the top while a sludge, like sediment, that contained the actual dye component settled. And once the separation was complete, the water was drained off and the mushy sediment containing the dye was transferred to the third and smaller vat. The third vat, this one was used to remove the excess water by gravitational draining. Sludge was poured into cloth, and it was usually Ansberg bags. You know, we're familiar with that cloth. Weights were applied to squeeze out the liquid. When the sludge dried into a muddy paste, it was worked by hand into a smooth consistency and then scraped into boxes where it was cut into squares called indigo bricks and left to stand in drying rags, drying rags. Bricks were covered at the top to shield them over shield them from the strong sun rays, which would crack and weaken the solution. And during this curing phase, air circulation was important, as was keeping insects away, because remember, what you have is organic material, so you have flies and other things that are going to lay larvae in there, and that's going to ruin it. So you have to protect it from all of that. The final phase is when it became hard and crusty and no longer soiled the fingers, it was removed from drying racks and packed in barrels to await transport. Barrels were shipped as soon as sufficient stock was accumulated and began in September, October, and continued into the first few months of the next year. Now, keep in mind that other plantations in the area were raising sorghum, there was cotton, and so the shipment that happened, usually they waited until everybody had enough of everything. They tried to pack it all in the same ships to make it more economical. So regarding volume, think 14 pounds to a vat, 5 to 6 vats per day, 183 to 217 vats from the first two cuttings, 2,600 to 3,000 pounds from the first two cuttings, and another 800 pounds from the third cutting. That's a lot. That's a lot. It's a lot of smell, too. Okay, Mary, can I get you to take the jar and pass it around? So I have some indigo powder. For God's sake, don't open it. You'll be so sorry. I'm going to have these smurfs sitting in here. But I want you to see what it looks like. Just pass it around. So we're going to talk about the chemical composition now. So as you can see, it's a dark blue crystalline powder. It's sublimes at 390 to 392 Celsius. Sublime is defined as a substance which changes directly into a vapor, and then when it's heated, it forms a solid deposit again. So think in terms of that happening. Indigo powder is insoluble in water, alcohol, or ether, but soluble in DMSO, chloroform, nitrobenzene, and concentrated sulfuric acid. Chemical formula, as you can see, the molecule absorbs light in the orange part of the spectrum. And I have studied a lot about color. The spectrum is huge. There are just so many things out there. You know, our eyes are designed to see just so much in color ranges. A lot of us don't have full color sight, believe it or not. And this goes to the orange spectrum. The compound owes its deep color to the conjugation of double bonds. That is, the double bonds within the molecule are adjacent and the molecular is planar, okay? That is the reason bonding is sometimes incomplete, allowing the color to do what we as dyers call crock off. So many times, even when dyeing with turkey red, you know, a lot of us in here are fans of turkey red, what happens is those molecules don't bond properly and it continues to crock off. So even many times, you know, and I've dyed indigo yarn a bazillion times, and this is some of it right here, even after several washings, I still have blue fingers, and that's why. It's the bonding of the molecules just never completes, no matter what you do. It has nothing to do with temperature, has nothing to do with the fiber itself. It just doesn't bond. Can't help that. Okay, and you can see from the skirt that I have here, this was dyed by a friend of mine, and she used uric acid, and you can see it's kind of splotchy, but that's what you get sometimes. It just happens. Okay, so how does it happen? So the precursor of the indigo is indican, and that's colorless. It's water soluble. It's a derivative of the amino acid tryptophan. We all know tryptophan because that's what is in your turkey dinner. Indican readily hydrolyzes to release beta D glucose and indoxal. Oxidation by exposure to air converts the indoxal to indigo. So that's what we're going to see when we go to the dye vat. Indigan was obtained from the processing of the plant's leaves, and they contain 0.2 to 0.8% of this compound. So then, in the dyeing process, sodium carbonate, a strong base, and also a pH regulator. Anybody who does a lot of dyeing, they know they have to know something about pH. In order to get fabrics or cellulose fibers to accept the dye and hold on to it, you need a catalyst. We call it a mordant. It's either a base or an acid. In this case, we need a base, a strong base. So it helps to maintain the stable alkaline conditions necessary for the action of the indigo dye. And what's going to happen, it disassociates into a weak acid, and then when you add it to the water, it changes into what we know as lye. And then it helps to ensure the proper chemical bonding with the cellulose plant fibers or protein animal fibers, depending on what we're using. And we're going to do immersion dyeing, okay? And then there's the oxidation. And I think this is where they, you know, they kind of thought that it had mysterious powers. because it's going to turn, you know, we saw the green.
The green changed the
food. It did. And when we put our fabric or whatever we're going to dye in there, we pull it out, it's going to be green and it's going to turn blue right before your eyes. And that's the oxidation. And that's what converts the indoxyl to the indigo. So that's really how it happens. Fermentation converts that glycoside indicant present in the plant to the blue dye in indigotten. Okay, make sense? All right. So here are the harvested plants. Next slide. And these are plants that are starting to break down, just so you see what it looks like. Next slide. This is the vat. And this is kind of what we saw out there. And so, you know, this looks really ominous, but it's cooking. It's the chemical reaction is happening, and that's why you're seeing the bubbles and the colors. Next slide.
And the heat helps that, right?
Yes,
that's
yes.
The purpose of
mm-hmm. Although it doesn't have to be, the water has to be warm, but not hot. So it's okay. It's okay. That's it. This is one of the great dyes because, you know, most of the time we have to cook it on the stove and it stinks up the whole house and everything. This one, no, you don't have to worry about that. Go ahead. Next one. And this is what comes out. And then next one. And here it is again, and now it's blue. This is a dye workshop I did at Keeley's Valley last year. And there's the dye vat. And you can see there's another one. It's a little bit green, but it's turning blue, and here's one that's going blue, and it'll happen in like 5 minutes or less. Yeah, next slide. So there's some blue yarn, and I have some blue yarn up here. You can see what it looks like. Next slide. Okay, so how did they use it? You know, what happened with all this blue dye? And there was a lot of fabric that was made during the early 1800s, late 1700s, that had these resist techniques applied. And I won't go into that because that's a whole other lecture, but this is the gist of it. So they used a resist of indigo dye paste to block dye penetration. Next slide. China blue. We all know about China blue. And that fabric there is very familiar to all of us. Well, it was a breakthrough. And they used unreduced indigo dye directly to the fabric. And they use large engraved copper plates to make that happen. You know, now we know. Yeah, now we know. Go ahead, next one. So this is discharge. And it's a printing method that came from the development of a bleaching paste. So they would put the paste on the blocks and hit the fabric and actually take the dye out. So it's a reverse. Yeah. Next. And then we have resist. And that was the large rollers to apply a resist paste before they dyed the fabric. So it's like a wax that was put on. And so that's what you have.
I've done batik,
mm-hmm.
the same concept?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got interested in all of this back in the early 80s. And a friend of mine taught shibori at the St. Louis Art Museum, and I took her class. And it started this love affair with indigo dye, and I've been doing it ever since. Shibori is a resist technique, and basically just take fabric and wrap it around anything. We use PVC pipe. And you just take cordage and just wrap it around, and scrunch it, do whatever. And when you stick it down in the dye, of course, all the resist is there, and you get these fabulous patterns. We did a lot of it with silk. It was amazing. Yeah. So that's it, folks. Any questions? Yes, sir.
I noticed how light that fabric is when mm-hmm. it dyed in the yarn, which mm-hmm. is almost like, what do they call it, chambray or cambray or
mm-hmm.
something. And, but I understood that the Royal Navy uniforms, mm-hmm. which were really dark navy blue,
mm-hmm.
were done with indigo.
They were, and the reason for the darkness is it was dyed numerous times. So numerous vats. To get that really dark, dark color, you're going to have to dye it numerous times. This is dipped twice, okay, and this is what you get. And obviously, this has been worn quite a bit, so it has faded just a tad. But that dark, dark blue comes from multiple dips. And, you know, when we get out back and we look at the dye vat, the things that go in first are going to be the darkest, and it'll reduce after that. that vat will handle 5 pounds worth of material. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Jeff, I know you're a master gardener. There's a flower called false indigo.
Yes.
How is that compared to true indigo?
It is the same genus. It is a different species. It's actually called Baptisa. And it is an ornamental. It has no dye qualities whatsoever.
Okay.
And then the wild ragged indigo, no color.
No problem. Mm-hmm. Yes, Russell.
We have a tablecloth at home that's silk that I got over in Malaysia. And I watched mm-hmm. the lady, she took a piping can with a little long neck mm-hmm. on it. It was full of hot wax.
Mm-hmm.
And she drew all the design all over the hot wax and let it sit.
Mm-hmm.
And then she dumped it in the dye and let it go through its process and it came out. And then what she did is they took hot water and the wax just rolled off. And mm-hmm. it was just exactly like that.
Mm-hmm.
But it was so magical to watch her with that wax put it, make all the designs. And she did it just, you know, so fast.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah, it is amazing.
Yeah, it's definitely amazing.
Yeah. It's a lot of fun. You know, I always say, you know, if you really want to wow your kids, do an indigo bath, you know. And you can buy it, you know. I mean, this isn't rocket science, and it's not anything that's difficult to do, and it comes with all the stuff. You know, you don't have to use lye anymore. The kit that I have came from Knit Picks, and it's $18. Not a big deal. And it'll dye 5 pounds. You know, and on a nice day, if I'm at home, you know, it's not uncommon for me to wash an entire fleece and dye it and lay it out on a rack and let it dry. Yeah. I know, my neighbors think there's something wrong with me. You know, there's little tufts of wool flying through the air, the bird's nests are made of wool, you know. So, we know where that came from. Yes,
so the indigo that's used today, like in these kits and things, mm-hmm. how is it produced today?
It's synthetic.
Oh.
Yeah. You can still get the real stuff in India. They still do make it. It's a little pricey. And honestly, it's not all that pure. It's kind of hard to work with.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Mary and I are dye partners. We've dyed many times, haven't we?
Next year,
you can do cochineal. Yeah. Well, yeah, we could do cochineal next year, yeah.
But if it's synthetic, why does it have the same qualities of turning it green and then oxidizing
it
blue?
It's the same process. Yeah, it really is. And I can't exactly answer that. I just know that the synthetic is made from the same chemical composition as the original stuff. Yeah, so it needs the same reactor. Yes?
You said some was native to Missouri as well?
Mm-hmm.
Was it produced here at all, or
is that enough? You know, that is a fabulous question. And I did try to find out if there was any indigo used in the St. Genevieve area, and I couldn't find nothing. However, if you notice the blankets tent had that blue strip through it, and you know, some of the goods that are over at the Felix Valley store have some blue, and I would have to believe that would have been indigo, because Vogue wouldn't have made it. It would not have, you know, wouldn't have existed. It just would have faded to nothing. And these are true blues that you see. So I think they probably came from indigo that was imported in, or came up the river from South Carolina.
We'd like to thank Deb for taking us on and giving the presentation. It was very informative, more than I could really understand. So, anyway, thank you very much for doing that, and we appreciate it. So, Sandra, can you come up here? Well, we've kind of built a relationship with St. Genevieve Tourism over the years, and we really appreciate the fact they give us this place where we can have these talks and help us with everything else. And the unit would like to give St. Genevieve Tourism a small token of our appreciation for letting us have this facility to speak in. Thank you, Sandra.